Hi, I'm James Schillinglaw, and I'm here on the Scenic Jasper at the Travel Expert Conference. And they actually have two ships that they're doing. We're sailing through the Netherlands and Belgium. And we're here with Susan Farrell, who's the owner of Travel Experts, and Heather McIntyre, who's head of technology and
finance.
Okay, I'll get that right. And we're going to talk to them about this conference, how they carried it out, because it was challenging, obviously, in the current environment. And then we're going to talk to them a little bit about what's going on with Travel Experts and its members today. You're going to hear all about that and more on Insider Travel Report. First of all, Susan, thank you very much for inviting me. It's been great. It's the first time actually I've been on Scenic, and we've known each other for a long time.
How many years now?
Oh, 30 plus.
Yeah, it's got to be that way. And so it's finally great to be at your conference here. Let's talk about that, about how, first of all, how many of your members are here?
Over 100 of our members, like 109, I think, right, of our members are here. Yeah.
And then their significant others and other things like
yes,
that.
Right.
And Heather, how difficult was this to pull all together? I know you had a big hand to it, because I got regular emails from Heather, and I was very bad at returning them, I got to say. But what was the challenges that you faced doing this?
Well, the original Summit 2, this is the second one we've done, was supposed to be in April of 2020,
right,
and we all know what happened then. It was rescheduled for April of 2021, didn't happen, but now we're here and it's November. I think we figured out that it was about 994 days in the planning.
Is that maybe the longest conference you ever planned?
I'm sure it would break some record somewhere, for sure.
Now, generally, you do have a conference every year, right? With the room?
This is only our second summit.
Okay.
Our big event, usually when we try to get everybody together, is for Virtuoso Travel Week in
right,
August.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah.
Yeah, and we usually have over 100 people at Travel Week, but this is kind of a secondary thing we've started doing. And it's kind of a mini Travel Week, and people are really liking it because it's more intimate.
Mm-hmm.
There's not, you know, thousands of people there. It's just us. And so we did one that was very successful, mm-hmm, started planning the next one right away, and already we're thinking about number 3.
There you go. Plus, you also have a captive audience here on two ships, although sometimes you got to say, wait a minute. No, they're on the other ship. That's what I know Sharon Fake is over on the other ship,
right,
and I'm luckily on your ship. So, and you're on this ship or not?
Yeah.
You are, very good. Well, we got Jasper is the best. No, there's no question about it. Now, what were some of the other logistical challenges you had, obviously, with COVID and all this? And did you have some resistance from members?
I wouldn't necessarily say there was resistance. When we really started getting underway again, it was probably in the spring. So we were still dealing with whether or not people were going to need to get vaccinated, if they were going to get vaccinated. There was a lot of turnover with the suppliers that were attending. So we have 39 suppliers. We were originally supposed to have, I think, 43. And there were some that due to...
That's not too bad a drop-off.
No, not really, no. And most of that was due to their own corporate, you know, they're not allowed to travel yet, or especially internationally. And then there was some turnover within the actual reps that came.
Yeah, I know. We've had a lot of challenges. But, of course, the big challenge you had, I remember a few weeks before that, is when the EU came in and said, well, first of all, we just are only going to accept vaccinated Americans, but we'll leave it up to the countries themselves. And the Netherlands came in and said, oh, we're going to restrict both vaccinated and unvaccinated, which was, as I was talking to one of the Dutch hoteliers the other night, a colossal error. And yet, yeah, all of a sudden, you were faced with that, right?
Right. I mean, we all panicked, honestly, because there was a maybe a 10 or 14 day span where we thought everybody that came was going to have to quarantine for 10 days if they flew into the Netherlands. But if they were coming from other countries, maybe that wasn't the case. So it kind of felt like we were about to be in some kind of caper where we were all flying to other countries and figuring out how to get here.
But then luckily they changed their mind.
It got reversed almost right away. And then the requirement that they had for testing prior to coming into the country got dropped about a week before we came for people that are vaccinated. So the rules, it was very just slippery.
Life in the COVID era, right?
Absolutely.
But still changing, right, almost daily, depending on whether cases are going up or down in a country. For
right,
instance, the Netherlands just changed
something else was changing.
Yesterday.
It was changing today in the Netherlands, and we're in Belgium, so we'll figure out what's going on there.
Well, I think we all got COVID tests earlier today, and we put them in. So life in the era of COVID, it's a challenge, that's for sure, but it can be overcome. So let's talk a little bit about Travel Experts itself. Susan, how many travel advisors, members do you have now?
We've got just shy of 500, like 480, I think. Mm-hmm. We had, before COVID, we were right around 500. Mm-hmm. I think we dropped down to about 400 right. during COVID. But a lot of people that we lost, people let their assistants go. Those were the first people to let go. They didn't have any business. They don't right. need their assistants. So we lost a lot of assistants. We were down to about 400 members during COVID. Things have ticked back up to almost five, almost the level where we were.
So you're back to your old level.
Yeah, almost. We lost people, but you know, we gained people during the same period of time because a couple reasons. Agencies were closing. Agencies were being acquired by larger entities, which didn't sit well with independent contractors. Agencies were changing their IC's contracts, which they didn't like the wording in their contracts. Mm-hmm. Travel advisors don't like a lot of changes.
No, so. Absolutely.
And plus, their business was down, so it was a good time to make a change. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't make a change when you are super busy. So during COVID, when things were kind of down, it was a good time to make a change. And a lot of people did.
And it sounds like you benefited from that because they were gone. Which, you know, now you've been a host. I'll do a little history here. I did a story for another publication back when I was with it. I think we called you the original host travel agency, and this was before the internet.
The perfect host.
The perfect host. Yeah, I know you used that for a long time.
Yes, we do. That's copyrighted, actually.
But think back to that time and how the host agency model has evolved, and suddenly you became the trend, right?
Yeah. Well, not suddenly. It took 32 years.
Well, that's pretty sudden, you know. I mean, it's been 32 years, but it was like, I remember in the late 90s, to be a host was not a good thing, but it changed pretty rapidly.
It
right?
did. It changed. Well, we opened in 1989 with myself and one other person, and it took a couple of years to get things going until we signed on one advisor who was a $1 million producer, and it made sense for her because our program really does not make sense for somebody who's new to the industry or just learning, you know, just starting out and their business is not well developed. We're more for the established advisor. So once we started with well-established advisors, $1 million producers, it caught on, and we started adding people one by one. When Sabre, you know, back then we were issuing airline tickets, one right after the other, at 10% commission or more, and lots of commission through Sabre. We're a Sabre agency. When Sabre came out with a program that enabled people to work remotely, they could work from their home or another office, that was when we really had the ability to grow because people didn't have to be located physically within our office. So it just kind of exploded from there.
And then, of course, the internet came in and got some crazy. Right?
Sure, everybody's connected now, no matter where they are.
Now let's turn back to the crisis at hand, the last 20 months. How have you helped your members get through this, would you say?
There's been,
Heather is clearly the number one person responsible for all of our behind the scenes efforts at our own financial stability as well as that of our IC. So I'll let her give you a rundown.
So what did you have to do in the last 20 months?
Oh gosh, so we're very versed in all of the PPP rules and helping all of our ICs that were applying for loans, the EIDL loan program and the grant program, learning a lot about unemployment in probably 30 different states just to help people figure out where to go.
That was the big thing, is that you actually could get unemployment as an IC, right?
Exactly. And ASTA helped a lot with that. A lot with helping us sort of figure our way through all the regulations and things we needed there. They were great. The employee retention tax credits. I mean, there's just been so many things that have programs that have been available, and just finding out about those programs and then trying to get that information out.
Well, you did a good job because now you're pretty much back up to what you were, and so these guys have survived.
Right. And there were some other things that were less, I mean, that were really more things that we did. Mm-hmm. Reducing the fees they're still reduced at this point, almost 2 years later. They'll be going back up soon, though.
Well, now apparently, you know, sales are coming in, thank God. You know, this is maybe by 2022, maybe you can do this, right?
Exactly. But for us being able to get the PPP funds and the tax credits, that made it possible for us to be able to reduce fees. Some of the other things, you know, right when everything happened, there were so many commission recalls as things were getting canceled. And one of the things that I've kind of learned is different about us than some of the other hosts is that we pay out commissions when we get them. We don't wait until the clients have traveled.
Which is a huge thing.
It's a big difference, right. And other agencies, I mean, we want everybody to get their money as fast as they can. So we were paying everything out, but that also meant then we suddenly had a lot of money that was due back to us. And this is a purely a Susan thing. We waited until people earned that money back. We didn't, you know, send them credit card links to pay us back. I mean, we sat on those negatives for a while. I mean,
no, that's good. I mean, that really is very useful.
We require that the recall commissions be paid back to us immediately. We let it ride until they had money coming back in, and it pays off in the end. We're kind of long-sighted. Yeah. You know, it's to our advantage because
certainly I'm sure they appreciate it.
They appreciated it. People stay with us. You know, I've got people who've been with us for 31 out of 32 years.
Yeah.
So we're long-termers.
Now, do you think the way you were structured as a host might have helped you a little bit to get through this pandemic?
I think the way that we are financially structured, yes. We don't have a lot of employees. We don't have a lot of layers of highly paid management, unfortunately. We don't have high rent. We're not in a high rent district of Manhattan or somewhere. We own our own building. Mm-hmm. So we don't have huge overhead costs. So, and our, you know, the way we're structured, we get a flat monthly fee from everybody. Our income is not dependent upon their commission level. So, you know, their commissions could be sky high for 6 months and we get a lot of money, but that's not the way we work. We get the same income every month, so we're pretty stable financially.
Right.
So yeah, it allowed us to kind of float over that whole COVID mess.
Yeah, no, and absolutely. And of course, now things are starting to come back. And is that what you're hearing from your members, that sales are coming for 22 and 23? What does it look like?
Things are looking very, very, very up. And honestly, we're getting more advisors that are coming. They need help. I mean, we're trying to get other people back into the industry as assistants and things like that to be able to help with the demand that we're seeing, because it's a lot.
So when do you think we're going to get back to 2019 levels, or are you already there?
I'm guessing next year, 2022, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, I mean,
some people are saying 23, but it's going to be the banner year, and some people are saying, no, we're going to get it the next 22.
I think there's a difference, though, between corporate travel and leisure travel and meeting and incentive travel. I mean, they're all kind of on a different track.
Right.
Corporate's definitely still a lot slower than leisure is, but people want to go out.
Well, we're seeing a surge in cruising. We're on a cruise ship, and you're hearing good things from even though they're still operating at on full capacity, they're seeing the bookings coming back, right?
They're full, and next year, cruises are full, yeah.
Now, is there anything else you want to get out to our 95,000 travel advisors about? It is a lot. We have a lot. We have a big database of travel advisors. I'm very gratified to see many of your folks are subscribers, and they like seeing the videos. So they'll see you there. They can see you on TV. They can see you live right now. It's amazing. So what do you think in terms of anything else you want to tell them and other advisors out there?
Well, I think they hopefully a lot of them know us already. Of course, our advisors do, but hopefully other people out there who are considering making a change have heard of us. They should know that we've been around for 32 years. We're solid as a rock. We kind of float above all the, you know, we floated above 9/11.
We've seen a lot of crises, Susan, in the last few years.
Right? Commissions being eliminated, an economic downturn, and now COVID. We kind of float above that. So we're here to stay. We're like a rock.
And so, Heather, how long have you been with Travel Experts now?
21 years.
21 years. So what would you like to tell the advisors out there about the company? Because you've been working here for a while, right?
Right. Well, something I tell a lot of people is that when I worked in banking before I worked in this industry, and I went through two mergers in 5 years. And when Susan actually bought the company that I worked at in Durham, and I, in my head, thought I would stick around for 6 months, get the company, you know, get the old company assimilated, and then find something else that didn't have so much change. And that was, you know, 21 years ago. It didn't go anywhere.
We haven't changed, have we?
Yeah, we haven't changed. The world has changed. The industry has changed. And honestly, that's why I love it. There's always something
from banking to travel. I think you made a pretty good shot there.
Yeah, it was a wise move.
So that's great. Now, where can all of our advisors go to find out more about travel experts today?
Well, we have two websites. One is www.travel-experts.com, and the other is Travel Professionals.
Independent travel professionals.com.
Yes.
Either one you'll find it. Okay.
Yeah. And I'm the one to talk to people who think they might want to join us. And
you go through and vet and sort of talk to people about whether they're good. Mm-hmm. And I know that for a fact because I've sent you a few agents over the years. I actually got some key lime pies out of that deal from Susan. It was we're not supposed to talk about that. I love all the hosts, but I don't get key lime pies from them. So that's a way to my heart. So listen, thank you very much. Congratulations on this. I know you've been working hard at this. Yeah. This conference. I know I'm getting a million emails from you, and you really were trying to pin everybody down, and they all got here, right?
Well, the thing that I think is funny, and everybody I think would agree with me, is that travel advisors are kind of their own worst travel advisors. Like they read everything at the airport on their way out of town, and they're, you know.
I'm guilty of that. I'm no different from that. Travel journalists are somewhere. We don't pay attention to the emails until we really have to. Right?
Exactly. So trying to get a couple hundred people to read that, you know, yeah.
Well, they don't think they do it, you know. I mean, I see them. It is odd because we all think we know it, and well, we'll do it. And I know for the same for travel journals. Yep. We think I got a million conferences I'm going to. I don't know. I don't barely pay attention. And I do apologize really for not getting.
I do the same thing. I just couldn't with this one.
Well, Susan, again, congratulations on this conference. Congratulations. It's great to hang out with
you
after 30 years, 30 plus years. It's been amazing. And again, thank you so much.
We'll be around for another 32.
Well, I hope we are.
I'll be well over 100.
Me too. I'm James Schillinglaw aboard Scenic Jasper with Travel Experts, and this is Insider Travel Report.